Good morning. Thank you for joining us during our worship service from 10:15 a.m. to 10:30 a.m. This is the time that we've set aside to share some of our favorite worship moments. If you have some favorite worship moments that you would like to see in the future, please let us know down below in the comments section. With that being said, grab your tea, grab your water, grab your juice, grab your coffee. Sit back and enjoy the throwback.
Oh, yeah. What you say now? What you say now? What you say now? In the city, in the field. What you say now? What you say now?
Church Worship Online, services through Facebook and YouTube. We are excited to have you worship with us today. Make sure you go to the interactive keys where you can talk to other members and family and friends during the worship service. If we have any guests visiting with us today, it is a pleasure to have you with us. And on behalf of our pastor, Dr. B.R. Daniel Sr. and Pastor B.R. Daniel Jr., we consider it a privilege to have you worship with us. Make sure you fill out a guest survey that's right there located on our website. It won't take long at all for you to fill that out. Thank you so much for coming, and please come again.
Thank you for joining us. Service will begin soon. Have a COVID-19 update from our health ministry leader, Ms. Laverne Campbell.
Nurse Campbell here. Hey, family. Well, it finally happened. Now we're being mandated to wear a mask anytime you're out in public. So, what a great time for us to talk about face covering, aka mask 101. Pull in real close because I need you to hear everything I have to say. The question is asked, when should I wear a mask? The answer to that is, anytime you're around people who you don't live with. Before I get started, I wanted to talk about some things that would help you to be more comfortable in a mask, especially for us glass wearers. The most annoying thing is to put on a mask and have your glasses to fog up. I have some remedies for that. The first one is, wash your glasses in warm, soapy water. Make sure the soap does not have a lotion in it. Don't dry them off, don't rinse them off, just let them air dry, shake as much as you can off, and just let it air dry. That should take care of that. The other one is my personal favorite. You take a small piece of tissue and you put it on the inside of your mask as such. And when you put your mask on, then the tissue will absorb the moisture. And when it hits your cold glasses, your glasses won't fog up. Another option is to side your glasses further down on your nose. And the last one is to modify your mask so that you have a good fit. Now, there is a wrong and a right way to wear a mask. When you wear a mask, it should cover your nose and your mouth. If it is below your nose and only covering your mouth, you don't really have on the mask and you're not really covered. That is not the way to wear a mask. If you're constantly having to adjust your mask and put your hand on the front of your mask to move it around, then that is not a good fitting mask and you're really, really putting yourself at risk, because when you touch the face front of your mask, then you put your hands on all the germs and all the viruses that you've been breathing in, and now they're on your hands. So it's imperative that you have a good fitting mask. Your mask should fit as such. Okay, here's my mask. Now, that's a good fit. See? There are so many different styles of masks and different colors, but the important thing is that you have a mask that fits. You can have a cloth mask, different styles. The important thing is that your nose and your mouth are covered. Another really important thing is to make sure that you keep your hands away from your mask. If you're constantly having to adjust your mask and to fix it, it's not a good fit. It needs to fit snugly on your face. Making sure you have a little space here, a little cup space, ideally, so that you can breathe in. Also, when you take your mask off, make sure you take it off, and you can either put it in a bag or you can put it in a sack, especially if you've had it on for a while. The masks need to be washed regularly. You just throw them in the washer, wash them. It's not recommended to dry them because they shrink. So you can just air dry them or hang them up. Lastly, let's talk about some of the myths that are circulating about the hazards of wearing a face mask. Just know that it's all fake news. There has been no research done on wearing of a face mask being harmful to you. In my 45 years of nursing, I have never ever heard of a physician or a nurse that have had complications or had any kind of illnesses arise from wearing a mask. And none of us are going to be wearing a mask for any prolonged periods of time, our once or twice a day for maybe an hour or two. So all of these myths are fake news. Okay? Love you, family.
Thank you for joining us. Church will begin soon.
Everybody, it's Ashley, and we are back with another Ministry Minute. Quote, if you don't tell your money where to go, you'll wonder where it went, unquote. Get ready. Next month, July 25th, starts our annual Knowledge is Power program. It's going to be from 10:30 to 12 via Zoom, and all ages are welcome and encouraged to participate. So make sure that you go to our website, click on the events tab, and make sure that you register. We'd love to see you there. It's that time again, care packages. I just want to specify that these packages are for any individual who may be elderly, disabled, or unemployed. In order to sign up, you can either fill out the form online or call the church. Whichever way you do it, just make sure that you do it by the first Sunday so that your care package can be delivered to you by third Sunday. You know what it's also time for? Lord's Supper. We want to make sure that you guys are able to participate in taking the Lord's Supper with us on first Sunday. So make sure that on either Saturday or Sunday coming up that you come to the church between the hours of 9 a.m. and 12 p.m. to pick up your Lord's Supper. If you're not able to pick it up, just make sure that you call your deacon so that you guys can schedule those drop-off times. Something really important I want to mention to everyone. We want to make sure that you guys were able to participate in our reopening survey. Text went out, but if you didn't get it, that's okay. Just make sure that you go to our website and click on the resources tab to participate so we can know how you feel about if and when church opens back up. Sad to say, guys, our graduate drive-in celebration has been canceled for today. With the rise in cases of COVID-19, we just have to make sure that we're taking those extra precautions and we're keeping everyone safe. But we do have a lovely, beautiful, big video presentation that will air next month, July on the third Sunday, and it will premiere on YouTube at 6 p.m. And lastly, I gotta ask you guys a question. Are you following us on Instagram? Do you follow the Beth Eden Twitter? Because you ought to be. On Wednesdays on Instagram, we host a little thing called Song for the Soul, where we like to post songs that inspire people and encourage people to get through the rest of the week. And on Twitter, we like to post inspirational quotes and scriptures, and also like to just have good open conversation. So make sure that if you're not, that you're following Beth Eden on those platforms. Well, guys, that concludes your Ministry Minute. See you next time.
Welcome. Services will begin shortly.
Such a privilege to be in the great outdoors. The great outdoors is a creation from a great God. Listen to the birds chirping. Listen to the wind. See the sunlight. I'm thankful that God has allowed us to be in His great creation. But God didn't just do this for us to enjoy. He wants us to show our thankfulness. Proverbs 18 and 16 says, "A gift opens the way and ushers the giver into the presence of the great." Who is the great? The great is God. Who is the giver? That is you. It's time for us to give. At Beth Eden, we have four ways in which you can continue to give, no matter when or where you are. COVID and quarantine has not changed the ability to give. The first way, text GIVING to the number 55469. Now think about this. We don't care if you have an iPhone, an Android, Cricket Wireless, Metro PCS, just go ahead and text. You can also go online to our website and click the tab Donate or download the Realm app. The third way, come to the church at 3208 Wilbarger and give your tithes or offering in person on Sundays from 9 to 12. A representative will be here waiting for you. And don't forget, my personal favorite, snail mail. It may be slow, but it's guaranteed to get there. Go ahead and send your tithe and offering to Beth Eden at 3208 Wilbarger, Fort Worth, Texas 76119. Four ways, choose one, but in all ways, give thanks to the great. Thank you for joining us. Service will begin soon.
Trusting Beth Eden with your prayers. We have deacons standing by right now here at the church from the hours of 10:30 till noon. If you're unable to call during those times, no worry. Make sure you fill out the form, the prayer request located on our website, and someone will get back to you. Thank you so much for trusting us with your prayer. Now let's get ready for worship service. I'm excited, aren't you?
Amen, brothers and sisters. It's so good to see you and meet you here again in this venue. Let's get a word from the Lord, and then we're going to bow in a word of prayer, and we're going to get into this wonderful worship that all of us have been anticipating. The Bible says in the 29th number of Psalms, "Give unto the Lord, O ye mighty, give unto the Lord glory and strength. Give unto the Lord the glory, do unto his name. Worship the Lord in the beauty of His holiness." Amen. Eternal Father, we come. We just glorify and magnify Your holy name. You are indeed awesome. We thank You for this day that You've allowed us to be a part of. Lord, even in the midst of this pandemic, You have been keeping us, and we're just grateful. Lord, thank You for that. We're able to meet even as we're meeting now. And so, Lord, we ask that You bless the singing. We ask that You bless the preaching. Let somebody get saved. Let some backslider come home. Lord, let someone who is watching, who has a broken heart, a hung down head, Lord, let the singing and the word go forth to minister to that person. That Master, once you're through with us this day, they'll lift their head and say, I feel like running on. Lord, we just bless your name. We thank you. And help us to be ever so mindful to give you all the praise and the glory. It's in the name of Jesus we pray, and we thank you, Lord. Amen, amen, and amen.
Glory to glory to the Lamb. Glory to the Lamb. We cry glory to the Lamb. Say glory.
Glory to the Lamb.
Glory to the Lamb.
To the Lamb. So grateful to God for the privilege of speaking to you today. I want to publicly thank my pastor for his permission and his absence for me to stand and to lead the body of Christ into another examination of the Word of God. If you would turn with me to Romans chapter 8, there's one verse there that sits within the chapter like a stick of dynamite waiting to go off and explode the power and the influence of the enemy in your life. I'm going to read it from a modern translation, Living English Bible, and I want you to read it along with me as we search for God's Rhema word unto us. Hear ye the word of the Lord, and likewise also, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as one ought, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with unexpressed groaning. I think I'm gonna read that one more time. And likewise also, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as one ought, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with unexpressed groanings. God, I can't do this without you, nor will I try. I need you afresh and again to not only illumine the people of God, but to illumine me as well. We pray, oh God, that you remove the power of the enemy and sin, and that right now you refresh us for such a time as this. It is the sincere desire of the preacher, oh God, that sin be forgiven, lives be changed, and destinies be altered through the power of your word. And all the people of God said, amen. It seems as if you search history and scripture, there have been historic calls to prayer. There have been historic times where things have happened or a need arose and some significant leader led the people of God, not to a physical act, but to a spiritual time with God called prayer that would create a desired outcome. In fact, when the law was found in the temple in the Old Testament, the Bible says that the people stopped everything and they engaged in a season of prayer. And yet, even in the New Testament, when Jesus surveyed the spiritual development of his disciples, he said, look, y'all, when you pray, I need you to pray like this. And starting with our Father who art in heaven, he gave him what we call the modern model prayer. And then it seems in the world in which we live, after each national emergency, every time something occurs within these United States of America, some preacher or some spiritual leader somewhere says that we need to stop what we're doing and engage in a season of prayer. And beloved, I don't know if you know this or not, but I think that COVID-19 and this coronavirus epidemic is a wonderful time to increase your capacity to pray. Now listen to how I say that. I say that very specifically. I say that very intentionally. I did not say to pray. I said to increase your capacity to pray. What does that mean? I think that this text should guide not only our understanding of prayer, but also that gift of God unto us, the action of prayer as well. For there are three things within this text that will increase your capacity to pray. There are three things within this text that will enrich your time in prayer. The first thing is that when you pray, you need to understand, first of all, that we lack the knowledge. I wish I had somebody's help here. Click like on your boy. Yeah, we lack the knowledge. We lack the knowledge. When we pray, I need you to understand that we lack the knowledge. Prayer is not a mental expedition of how much you know. It is not a test of how intelligent you are. It is not your ability to craft wonderful, beautiful sentences, but prayer is a gift from God which draws the saint unto himself. The text clearly says that we don't know how to pray as we should. We don't know how to pray as we should. Get this, in spite of this being a knowledge economy, in spite of us being able to Google or to search any particular factoid that we need, you can't Google how to pray. I wish I had somebody's help here. In fact, not only can you not Google it, you cannot key on yourself or other people. Prayer is a gift from God. There are seasons in life where we don't know what to pray for or what we should say or how we should say it. There are seasons, and some of you have experienced it now in this COVID-19 cycle, where you kneel in front of the foot of your bed and your heart is still and you passionately search for the presence of God. And instead of being filled with language, your mouth is silent because you do not know what to say. But not only that, you can't cue on someone else. Prayer is not what other people say. Prayer cannot be based upon what another person has contributed. I'll never forget, while I was at Wedgwood Middle School here in Fort Worth, Texas, I was the star of the musical, The Ransom of Red Chief. And on our first full rehearsal, I walked out on stage, I looked at the crowd, and I forgot everything I had memorized for my lines. And there, as I surveyed the crowd, there down in front of me was my theater teacher, who was moving her mouth, and I couldn't understand what she was saying. So she stopped the production, pulled me to the side, and said, "Royal, if you ever get lost as relates to your lines, if you look at me, I will give you exactly what to say." And beloved, I wish prayer was like that. I wish there were people who could tell us what to say in those seasons when we don't know what to say. I wish there were people who could share with us what to express when we don't know what to express. And the wonderful thing, and yet the horrible thing about prayer, is that by ourselves, we cannot pray, for we lack the knowledge. But then secondly, not only do we lack the knowledge, we also need some help. We lack the knowledge, but then two, we need some help. The Bible says something interesting here, because not only does God know that we don't know. Yeah, see, it's one thing to know you don't know and nobody else knows that. But God knows that we don't know how to pray, and yet he's taken a response to the fact that we don't know how to pray. The Bible says, watch this. I need you to get this. It says that in the same way, the Spirit helps with our weakness. You just missed me. I can see that in your habitual listening to the virtual sermon that you were just lulled into a period of inactivity and listening. But I need you to catch that. It says that the Spirit helps with our weakness. That's a wonderful word. What does that word help mean? That word help has two implications from the Greek in which it comes from. The first is, one, when the Spirit helps, he shows up. I wish I had somebody's help here. You just missed the shout. You just really missed the shout. Is there anybody who's ever been alone in a strange place where you didn't know anybody? Have you ever been in a place where you didn't know anybody in the room, and the moment you saw somebody you knew, your heart just lifted, a smile came on your face? Why? Because you recognize that I may not know anybody else, but I'm not in this place by myself. And the first thing I need you to understand is that even in this COVID-19 situation, with record numbers of cases increasing every day, I've come by to tell the body of Christ that you are not in this thing by yourself. That if you look into the hinterland of your life, you can testify that Jesus is here. But not only did he show up, that's the second part of that Greek word help. The second part of that Greek word help is, the first part is he shows up, but the second part is he participates in your situation. In other words, not only does he show up, he shares cares, whatever your trouble is. See, there are a lot of folk who show up, but they ain't gonna do nothing. There's a lot of folk who sit with you, but they can't help you. But do I have any witnesses, either live or virtual, who can testify that we serve a God that not only will he show up, but he will participate in your misery. He will lift your burdens. He will put a smile on your face when the enemy is trying to steal your joy. If there's anybody here, you need to put your hands together and tell God, thank you. And if you listen to me virtually, you need to click like on your boy, because the Lord has been good to all of us. Yeah, y'all had to excuse me. Let me get my urbanity back. Y'all got to excuse me. Let me get my poise back. Yeah, not only does he show up, but he shares the load. Not only does he show up, but he gets busy. And right now, in the still of your home, in your pathways to your destiny, I want you to sense and feel the fact that God is present. You know, I'm certain that the enemy wants us to forget that. I'm certain that the enemy wants us to focus on the trouble and not on our Savior. I'm certain that the enemy wants us to think that not only is God not present, but God is not active. And might I remind the body of Christ and put the world on note that even in the midst of all of this, not only is God present, but God is participating. Well, how does he participate? I'm so happy you asked me, because the first time in a long time, families are sitting down. I wish I had somebody up here. For the first time in a long time, wives and husbands are having conversations. For the first time in a long time, children are speaking to grandparents and great-grandparents. Even in the darkness of COVID-19, I believe that God is active, changing the quality of life, while we focus on the quantity of life. I wish I had somebody's help here. Click like on your boy. So watch this. Not only do we not know what to pray for, and not only do we need some help, thirdly and finally, let me get out of this thing. We need a representation. We need a representation. Listen to my language, because I want to be faithful to the text. He says, watch this, in the same verse, and I can stay here all day, but I'm not. I got to get out of here. Get this. He says, watch this, in the same verse. He says, not only one, we don't know what to pray for. Two, we don't know what to pray for. Two, we need some help. But three, we got to have some reputation. One, we don't know what to pray for. Two, we need some help. Three, we need representation. Now, notice the terminology that I use, because the text says that the Spirit himself intercedes for us. Circle that word, intercede. That word intercede is a significant word that every saint needs to know, because it's a word you need to shout. Get this. Literally, what Paul is doing in the work is he's painting a legal image. That word intercede is a legal word that literally means to stand before the judge. I wish I had somebody's help here. And to plead the case of your client. I wish I had somebody's help here. That word intercede means, that when we pray, that God is the judge and we are in court, but we have a lawyer who represents our case to the Lord. Now, can I tell you why that's important before I get out of here? Yeah, let me tell you why that's important before I get out of here. Because all of us have reasons in our life why our prayers should not be answered. I wish I had somebody's help here. And I know I have some supercalifragilistic holy people in the place, and also listening virtually. But for those of us who've come up the rough side of the mountain and enjoyed the trip, I wish I had somebody's help here. We have reasons why our prayer should not be answered. But beloved, the beautiful thing about it is that every time the enemy brings up a reason why our prayer should not be answered, the Holy Ghost, I wish I had somebody's help here, is pleading our case before the Lord. Which means that when I don't know what to say, help me, Holy Ghost, when I cannot verbalize my concern, I've got an advocate standing before the Father who can bombard heaven on my case. Yeah. Can I tell you two implications, and I'm going to get out of here. There are two implications that I need you to get, and then I'm gonna get out of here. Don't miss the shout. Get this. The text says how he does it. Yeah, get this. It says that he didn't just stand there with a smile on his face. The text says that he does not just stand there with a resolute face that shows no emotion. But the Bible says that when the Holy Ghost pleads before the Lord on our case, he does it with groanings that are not done with the mouth. Yeah, that word groanings means to be physically moved with a verbal response. What does that mean? It means that everything folks say about God is not true. There are some folks who would tell you that God is not concerned about his children. That God even now is not concerned about the church, preachers, or the people of God. But I come by to let you know that this text says that no, if the Spirit is groaning before the Father, that what we go through influences God. Can I make it plain that when we hurt, God hurts. That when we're sad, God feels it. That when we go through, we are not by ourselves. We serve a God who is moved by what moves us. The Bible says he loves us so much that he's groaning before the Father, pleading our case. But can I tell you this? Get this. What I love about this legal piece is that every case is different. And I think I'm going to take my seat on this. Yeah, every case is different. See, that means he's not just pleading for me, and he's not just pleading for you, but he's pleading for all the people of God. Because all of us have a different need when we come before the throne of grace. Doesn't that blow your mind that everywhere right now on this Sunday morning, there are millions, possibly billions of people who have needs that they are lifting up to the Lord. And God does not need a secretary, nor does he need a distribution system. He doesn't need trucks to keep tabs of who needs a car and who needs a house. But whatever you need, wherever you are, God can handle all of our needs all at the same time. Get this, it's a fresh plea with every fresh saint. That means that when you call on the Lord and when I call on the Lord, we may not need the same thing, but thanks be to God, he knows exactly what we need and he gives it to us fresh. Good evening, y'all. I'm going to close with that. Yeah, we don't know what to pray. We lack the knowledge. And then secondly, we need some help, but we need fresh representation. I think I'm going to go to my seat on this. I was a kid growing up in the south side of Fort Worth. And if you wanted candy on the limited resources that we had, you did not go to the grocery store because that was your most expensive option. And there were seasons where you didn't even go to the corner store because although it was less expensive, it was not the least expensive. Click like on your boy if you're from the south side. Yeah. So the thing is, if you wanted the least expensive, most beneficial option, you would find what we call in Southside vernacular the candy lady. I wish I had somebody's help here. And so after every game and after every party, we would go to Colvin Avenue. I'm not no snitch. I'm not going to give you the address, but it's on Colvin Avenue and she's still slaying candy today. But you'd go to Colvin Avenue and we'd all pack up in there. And my thing was a Snickers. We all love Snickers. Why? Because Snickers really satisfies. I wish I had somebody's up here. Click like on your board. And so on one day, I came in with all the people from the block. And it was so chaotic. It was so crazy that I couldn't get close to my Snickers. I had hands above me. I had hands coming around me. And it was so chaotic in the room that I stepped back and said, look, you get what you want, fellas. I'm gonna wait until you're finished. But the thing is that when we were finished, I stepped back up to the table and all the Snickers were gone. And 11, I don't know if you know this or not, but when you really want some candy and you see that candy in view and someone takes the last piece of candy, that is a gastronomical emergency. I wish I had somebody's help here. And so I was mad.
I was kind of angry. I was about to leave, and the candy lady on Hovind Avenue grabbed me by the shoulder, and she said, "Don't leave, don't leave, don't leave. All your folks took my last snicker, but I'm gonna open up a fresh pack for you. Click like on your boy." I think I'm gonna leave on that. That's exactly what I want to tell you. Is there anybody in this house who can testify that when the enemy takes all the candy, when COVID takes all your joy, when sorrow tries to make you crazy, we serve what I call a fresh pack God? Won't he give you a fresh pack praise? Won't he give you a fresh pack song? Won't he give you a fresh pack joy? Throw away that old pack. Let the other folk go first. Because what God has for you, it is. And it can only be possessed by you. Yeah, that's it. That's it. That's it. That's all I got. That's all I got. Yeah, we need some help. We don't know what to pray for. We really don't. Secondly, we lack the knowledge. We don't know what to pray for. The spirit intercedes. But then thirdly and finally, we have fresh representation, which constantly bombards heaven with the significance of our own plea. During this season of COVID-19, won't you spend more time engaged in prayer? Won't you spend more time in the silence of God, focusing on his speech and less on your own? May God bless you. May God keep you. Father God, we thank you for prayer. We thank you for the fact that even though we don't know what to pray for, the Spirit intercedes on our behalf. Thank you for making prayer a combination effort between your spirit and our souls. And oh God, during this season of COVID-19, oh God, give utterance to the saints who struggle in prayer, who labor in prayer, who really don't know what to say. Allow them to understand that even when they can't speak, the advocate, the Holy Spirit, is speaking on their behalf. God, we thank you for your son, Jesus Christ, and if there be anyone who's heard these words, virtually or in person, that does not know of what your son did to save our souls and to free us from the enemy, we pray that they would know that if they confess and believe that Jesus died on the cross and was raised on the third day, that they shall be saved. And it's in the mighty and majestic name of Jesus the Christ we pray and ask it all. And all the people of God said, amen.
Service was great. I'm so glad I took good notes. And in case you didn't, don't forget, after today's premiere, you can always hit the rewind button. And we also have all the information available for the rest of the week's services in the announcement key. We have Wednesday night Bible study at 7 p.m. We also have prayer with Pastor Daniels Thursday at 12:30 p.m. So there's so many other good things going on. Make sure you keep up with what's going on at Beth Eden Baptist Church. We look forward to seeing you next week.
God, how we thank you for everything you do. We thank you for the provisions that you've made for us, oh God, in your word. You provide food, clothing, shelter, and for those things that are not obvious, you've given us prayer. God, as we continue this week, make prayer easier for us as we labor with you. And then, oh God, as we continue in our lives and go back to the things that we do on a daily basis, let us take the message of Christ with us. May we share to men and women, boys and girls, that the same Christ who saved in AD 33 is the same Jesus who saves in 2020. Go in peace.
Looking at the Lord out there. Is that all right? Oh, you know what? I'm getting a bill.